Lafayette.
The President. Members, please remain standing while the Chief Executive enters the chamber. The Chief Executive. Chief Executive, welcome to the meeting. The Chief Executive will first address the Council. Chief Executive. President, members, yesterday I delivered my second policy address in my term of office. The title is A Vibrant Economy for a Caring Community. It spells out a key task of the government in the coming year. My policy tenet is to uphold the One Country, Two Systems principle, strengthen the economy, and improve people's livelihoods. The policy directions are to sharpen our edge and grasp the opportunities, address our shortcomings and any potential risks. My policy objectives are to make Hong Kong a better place for all, and people are able to enjoy a better living environment, students to receive quality education, and young people to fully realize potential, and the elderly will be taken care of properly. So we have a cohesive and caring community, and our economy will be vibrant where everyone can enjoy life. On the 1st of July last year, President Xi Jinping delivered an important speech. I will continue to go by the important points of four must and four proposals, and that Hong Kong will only prosper when its young people thrive as our governance blueprint. Now we are seeing an unprecedented challenge and change in the geopolitical situation and around the world, and then there are also increasing competition around the world. So we need to have perspective of the overall situation, and we need to have a global perspective. Only then can we take advantage of the backing of the country and our connection to the international world. And then Hong Kong could maintain its status as a metropolitan world city, and then we could work closely with the country and other places. And then because the economic focus will shift to the east, so we need to maintain our competitive edge against all these backgrounds. And then the government must strengthen governance and develop our institution. We will continue with our results-oriented approach, and then we'll lead the administration to get real work done. And then we are going to promote development capacity, increase our capacity, so that we could continue to develop the economy. We will continue to troll for talents and enterprises, and we will also nurture local talents. And then we must strengthen our eight centers, well, that is the finance, aviation, arts and culture, innovation, technology, aviation, and other hubs. And then we will also be diversifying our economic development. We are going to revitalize the tourism, and then we are going to promote a new energy transport industry. And then we will announce the action plan for the Northern Metropolis. It's going to be industry-led infrastructure-led. Providing housing, and then we're going to continue to boost quantity, quality, speed, and efficiency. We've already announced a 10-year plan for 410,000 units. It actually exceeds the 308,000 units, which is the target in the 10-year long-term housing strategy. I will seize upon these hard-earned opportunities. And then I'm going to set up a task force on tackling the issues of subdivided units, where this is a key step towards tackling this tough issue. And then we have various measures to promote childbirths. And then different groups such as persons with disabilities, the elderly and carers, I have taken into account their needs and have come up with various initiatives. We are also going to promote our healthcare sector so that it will become an innovation hub for healthcare services. And then we're going to move towards the target of developing Hong Kong in establishing a drug approval authority based on primary evaluation. And then we are also going to have a new talent training. We're going to establish universities of applied sciences that will provide more opportunity for the young people. And then also we're going to promote vocational education so young people have various prospects. Now, I've spent about 3 months preparing this policy address. I've consulted different sectors. I've held many different consultation sessions. I also went to districts to listen to the views of local residents. So through various channels, I've been collecting views from the public, for example, the social media and so on. And we have received 8,700 submissions. I thank each and every person or members of the public who gave me their views. They've helped me decide on the priorities and focus of my policy address. Now, I've also adopted a large number of proposals put forward by members now that we have patriots administering Hong Kong. For example, the new birth cash bonus, promoting e-commerce, developing tourism products with special features, and then promoting patriotic education and developing new energy and so on. Now, I can't read out everything with the time constraint, but this shows that after we've improved the electoral system, there is now positive interaction between the executive and the legislature. So with the executive-led structure and with patriots administering Hong Kong, we are seeing the value of such a structure, contributing to our development. I will continue with the chief executive's interactive answer and question and answer session, and also the anti-chamber exchange session. I thank members for giving their views in these sessions. And then together, we could put our brains together to consider issues for Hong Kong and come up with solutions. And then after all these sessions, of course, I will follow up on all the issues raised. Now, I'm attending this question and answer session today to answer your questions. All the secretaries of departments and directors of bureau and other colleagues will also be giving you the details of the new initiatives at the various panel meetings. We'll answer your questions and listen to your views. So you have a better understanding of the policy address. Now, some measures such as the lowering the stock duty, transaction stamp duty, and relaxing the property tax stamp duty, and for example, bringing in a mechanism on redomiciliation of companies. Well, these all involve legislative amendments. So through communication and through listening to members' views, we could have adequate discussion in this council, and then we will win over your support on my initiatives. I'm now happy to answer members' questions. Members have been informed that the speaking time limit for each member is 2 minutes. Members may put questions to the chief executive or express their views or both when they speak. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. Mr. Kenneth Lau. Good morning, President. The policy address proposes to popularize sports activities. Each year, there will be a day when all sports venues are open to the public for free. There will also be more training for elite athletes and coaches. I support that. But in terms of making sports, it's sports for all, what about sports athletes in between, the general public and elite athletes? There are those who aspire to become professional athletes, so I hope there will be a proper ladder for them. Now, for adult full-time athletes, they only get $7,120 per month for allowance, and it's not enough for them, so they have to take up other jobs on top of the training. But, and you know, at local districts or you know, the training of junior and adult professional athletes, that's where we find talents to become elite athletes. So would you consider giving more support to athletes? So for those who aspire to become elite athletes, they won't be deterred because they can't make a living as a professional athlete. Chief Executive, thank you for your question, Mr. Lau. The government is promoting sports development on various fronts. In the policy address, I've mentioned five aspects. You know, going for elite training. You know, we want to make sports an industry, and we want to make it sports for all as well. And of course, we want our athletes to perform better and better. With elite athletes, we can see that sports development has yielded results in Hong Kong, given the performance of these elite athletes. This year, we're spending $7.4 billion on sports development. That's a huge portion of our expenditure. But is it worth it? Well, we can tell from the performance of our athletes at different competitions. They are doing really well. Of course, for elite athletes, we're going to plow in substantial resources because they are competing against others who receive substantial resources from the government as well. So for them to be able to compete, we need to make sure they are in top form. For other sport areas of sports development, first, we want everybody to embrace sports. We want to give more opportunities for those who want to pursue a career in sports. Now, as to who we help in the process, there is a need to set priorities, it's true. At the moment, we see that if some athletes are doing well, they could, of course, be included in our priority training programs. And for others, we have to go through sports associations and other associations, so we could help these athletes improve their techniques, for instance. So we shouldn't just leave it to the government. I hope the community as a whole will share the same goal. I see there are organizations that sponsor athletes with skill training and so on. So as we deploy resources to this policy area, of course, we have to go by the overall priorities of government policies. And we've done much on training coaches other than training athletes. Anyway, we welcome all views from different sectors. The Culture, Sports and Tourism Bureau is in charge of promoting sports for all and sports development. Now, how can we put together the resources of community to help athletes develop better? Well, we welcome views from you. And if we need to take a lead in certain areas, we'll certainly do so. Dr. An Man Yu, well, yesterday you announced a mass transit system. Many residents in East Kowloon and Kai Tak told us, finally, after all the study, you have embarked on this project. They think you are being very decisive and committed to improving people's livelihood. So you adopt a result-oriented approach. There are KPIs to monitor progress and performance. Now, many residents in East Kowloon and Kai Tak want to know exactly when the mass transit system will be in place. They are afraid that you will be doing more studies and they have to wait longer. Chief Executive. Well, yes, we proposed a green and advanced mass transit system. It's included in the policy address. Definitely, we're going to do it. next year, we plan to ask the different parties to submit a letter of intent. Why are we doing that? Because we need to do some comparisons. For instance, are there interested bidders and what are their proposals? And then we have to then decide on how we'll prepare the tender document. And then we'll have to consider the actual operation considering the individual circumstances. And so next year, we're going to invite letters of intent. And then after that, we will issue a tender document. I think for East Kowloon and Kai Tak, probably they will be the first to, you know, for us to proceed with the projects, because for Kai Tak in particular, many have put forward the demands, and I thank members for conveying these demands to us. We've heard your views, and I thank my colleagues for taking a pragmatic approach. Well, yes, there have been various changes, but now we've decided to go ahead with it. It's included in the policy address, and I am result-driven, as you know. Of course, we are more than prepared to listen to more views at the panel meetings or in future when we need to seek funding approval. Definitely, we will have discussion with you, and I look forward to your views. I appreciate that in terms of the roadmap, you would like us to hear more views. So please do tell my colleagues what you think. And I'm happy to tell you this. Now, we have this free, green and new mass transit systems. Colleagues have been really forthcoming with their views, and they're very much involved, and I thank them for their involvement and commitment. And we also welcome views from you further. Thank you.
Mr. Benchen, Chief Executive, thanks for accepting the DAB's comments and at two new stations in Tsuen Wan so that the East Rail Line can play a more important function. Then people will be able to go to Kowloon Tong directly from Tsuen Wan, and people appreciate your proposal. But I want to ask about logistics development in Hong Kong in terms of our container terminals in Hong Kong. This year we have processed 3.43 million containers. And compared to 2019, we see a drop of 1.4 million containers. In paragraph 74 of your policy address, you put forward a number of proposals. However, the cargo throughput in container terminals have continued to drop, and the cost for hiring truck drivers have also gone up. It seems that there are no concrete proposals to address these issues. I think the container terminal should be relocated. Because the geographical advantage of this container terminal has gone, I wonder if the chief executive will consider relocating the container terminal and incorporate into one of your proposals. Perhaps we can work with other container terminals and in Kwai Shan Island build one of the biggest container terminals in the world. Instead of competing with the others, perhaps we can create a win-win situation. I wonder if you will consider such proposal. Thank you. Chief Executive. Thank you, Mr. Chen. Mr. Chen mentioned about paragraph 74 of the policy address about international shipping center development. How are we going to leverage our advantages and develop ourselves into an international shipping center? In paragraph 1 under paragraph 74, it's about action plan on maritime and port development strategy. This particular action plan will mention what kind of measures we will roll out. We describe it as an action plan because we want to roll out some concrete measures and initiatives to leverage on our advantages in maritime and port. And we want to promote trade with these advantages. Also, in my policy address, I mentioned that there will be an action plan on modern logistics development. These two action plans are interrelated. To develop marine and port, we need logistics support measures. So we will promulgate an action plan on modern logistics development. The relevant bureaus and government departments will elaborate on how we're able to boost our handling capacity and values in logistics sectors as well as the marine industry. We have conducted internal studies ourselves to set a priority. I think we should catch up with time and yield results first. I also mentioned in my policy address about the advantages we have in the marine sector. In terms of the local maritime network, we are one of the four designated arbitration centers in the world. And this is not an easy achievement. Also, in terms of maritime union activities, there are people with influence who are in the local unions, and they are the forces that help drive the development of the sector. We also have high value-added maritime services such as ship rental, and our laws as well as insurance services also have a role to play. Mr. Chen mentioned about the drop of our cargo throughput, but around the world, the trade sectors of different countries have been affected. I understand that the cargo throughput is not desirable in terms of its the statistics or figures because of geopolitics as well as conflicts in regions. We are affected. So we will release the details in the two action plans. Thank you. Dr. John Lee, Chief Executive. We're facing cybersecurity threats around the world. I am glad to see that there will be legislative exercises and put forward by the government. We see cyber threats recently, and this affects the well-being of our citizens. I, together with experts, will set up a group to combat on cyber threats in the community. I have received complaints from a lot of victims recently, and a lot of them have lost a lot of money in these frauds. Some aren't able to sleep because of the loss of money. Some are afraid to tell their families about the loss of money. I understand that the police have been working hard to conduct the investigations. However, in light of the large number of victims, I wonder if the chief executive have any measures in place to help these victims and prevent these frauds. Thank you. Chief Executive. We will hold the criminals accountable, and we will stand with the victims. That means the devils are the ones who swindle money from people. So we will stand with the victims to pursue the responsibility of lawbreakers. We want to prevent people from falling victim to frauds. The police have done a lot of work in this regard, and together with the trade, they have done a lot. I'm glad that Dr. Is going to set up an alliance, which is an anti-scam alliance, to help people stay vigilant against different kinds of scams. I understand that people are concerned about these scams, and I understand their situation. Before I became a politically appointed official, I already saw an increasing trend of scams. Well, there is a 24-hour hotline service set up by the police, and together with the trade, when we see some suspected frauds, we try to intercept the lots of money of people. We've helped elderly people as well. We've rolled out different mobile apps recently to help people check if there are suspicious phone calls. We've also rolled out the real name registration system for phone cards. People have been making use of technology to commit fraud, and scam phone calls has been a trend around the world. Hong Kong is not alone in this regard. We are trying to work with the mainland authorities as well as the police on the mainland. I want the Security Bureau to hold more seminars or conferences on anti-fraud efforts. We may need to hold seminars or conferences involving more than one law enforcement agencies or law enforcement agencies from different places. We want to draw reference from the law enforcement effort of the mainland as well as the Interpol. We want to hold international conferences. This is because a lot of times victims have heard our messages from our promotional efforts or publicity work, but they don't believe that they will fall victim into these frauds. We want to help people stay vigilant, and we will consider all kinds of proposals that may help people to stay vigilant and be alert. In the policy address, I mentioned about some digital policies that we will roll out. We have set up a dedicated office for rolling out digital policies. We will work hard together to boost cybersecurity. Thank you. Professor Chen Wing-Kwong. Good morning, Chief Executive. I'm glad to see that there is a part dedicated to Chinese medicine development in your policy address. I think this shows that the current government attaches importance to Chinese medicine development. You mentioned about promoting testing of and scientific research on Chinese medicine, but I think this is not enough. In terms of our testing capacity, Hong Kong has different advantages that we can make use of. If we do not leverage on these advantages, we will miss out on the opportunities to develop Chinese medicine. I wonder how the Chief Executive will make use of these advantages to further promote testing of and scientific research on Chinese medicine so that Hong Kong can become a center for testing or quality Chinese medicine development. Thank you. Chief Executive. I thank people who has the enthusiasm to promote Chinese medicine development. In my policy address, I describe how we can drive the development of Chinese medicine in Hong Kong. We will formulate a Chinese medicine development blueprint. It takes time for us to recruit a commissioner for Chinese medicine development, and we are coming to the final stage of this recruitment exercise. We will hire someone with experience in Chinese medicine. The first thing that this commissioner has to do is to formulate a Chinese medicine development blueprint. and the commissioner will help promote Chinese medicine development in Hong Kong. So where do our advantages lie? I agree that it is our testing capacity. Our testing capacity has been recognized by many, and we want to further develop these advantages. I've included this part in my policy address. It means that we will pay a lot of attention and resources in this area. So first, we will develop a digitalized Chinese medicine platform. We will open up this platform. We want to enhance people's understanding and knowledge about Chinese medicine. And after we've opened up this information platform, we'll know how we can do better. I'm sure I will be able to gather your insights when we have future discussions in the Legislative Council. I'm glad that Professor Chen raised this question because it makes me feel more confident about our path on developing Chinese medicine in Hong Kong. When our first Chinese medicine hospital starts operating, we'll be able to further our development in Chinese medicine. Over the years, we've been relying on Western medicine. Now we are facing a turning point. I've spared quite a big part in my policy address to describe how we can promote Chinese medicine development. I hope that by the time when the development blueprint is rolled out, you'll be able to offer more of your views and comments so that we can better implement measures. Thank you.
Mr. Robert Lee, thank you, Chief Executive, for a comprehensive policy address that will develop our economy and improve people's livelihood. And also, there's much coverage on the developing Hong Kong into various international centers. And then we see there are various measures about us being a financial sector, for example, asset management and new fund platforms, reform of the listing rules, and so on. Now, of course, the sector must also move with the times, and we need to go for diversity. But then there are many external factors that are beyond our control, of course, like the geopolitical situation, the interest rate hikes, and economic recovery that takes time too. And some believe that lowering the stock transaction stamp duty is a measure to enhance our competitiveness. Of course, we can't just rely on lowering stock stamp duty to address our plight. But then the market believes that you are not being aggressive enough in lowering the stamp duty rate, because now we are struggling to survive in our business. So I hope you will restore the stamp duty rate to the level before 2021 August. So is there room for further reduction? And why is it that you did not go for a more proactive or aggressive approach? Chief Executive, thank you, Mr. Lee. Now, as I decided on various measures, I've explained in the policy address, I have considered the task force on enhancing stock market liquidity. I've considered their report. I've actually taken on board all the recommendations in the report. And in the report, there are various measures that would take time to be implemented. For measures that could be immediately taken, that's reducing the stamp duty for stock transactions. The report has offered different options. How much should the reduction be? Of course, it's hard for us to come up with a scientific and very precise calculation because many factors are involved. In the stock market, against the high interest rate cycle, global stock market situation, and so on, these are all factors that may affect the transaction volume of securities. So apart from enhancing liquidity, I'd also like to enhance our competitiveness. So we need to remove the negative factors that undermine ROH. In the past, the rate was 0.13%. At the time, we wanted to, you know, increase our revenue. That's why we chose to increase the stamp duty rate. Of course, we could consider going back to the previous level. That's 0.1%. And that's actually the first option that came up. And then we have to consider that stamp duty is a source of revenue for the government. Now, we have done different calculations on the foregone revenue with different percentage. But it's hard to tell because it depends on the transaction volume. And there are many factors that affect the transaction volume. It's not just the stamp duty rate. And that's why I decided that I first immediately adopt a balanced solution. I've considered all different views and factors. I've also considered need to enhance liquidity, and I came up with this decision. Now, the task force on enhancing stock market liquidity came up with a series of measures. Other measures are listed out. The trading spread that will also affect transaction volume, and then data fees. Because if investors have more information, they'll be more confident in making investment. So we're lowering the data set fees as well. And certainly, the GEM market, we're going to reform that, and that's been announced. And fourth point, I said that there are many other measures. So for example, how can we bring more companies to list here? And what about a repurchase of stocks and during inclement weather, how do we maintain trading? Because Hong Kong is the only international stock market that has not achieved that. So how do we do that? So that's why I've explained all the various issues that we need to take to further promote our stock market as an international market, and then we will keep reviewing what measures we need. Thank you, Mr. Edward Leung. Thank you, President. Thank you, Chief Executive. Now, I went to talk to residents after the policy address. There's very positive response. Some told me every policy initiative in the positive dress is pragmatic, and they say if there's a CE election, definitely Johnny is going to be re-elected. No one would beat him. So that shows that people very much endorse the policy address. Now, I'd like to talk about some public dental services. Now, the DAB has astro expansion of dental services, and I thank you for taking on board that suggestion. Now, in the past, only primary students and the elderly could enjoy public dental services, and now in the post address, secondary students would be able to enjoy the service that's those aged between 13 and 17 year old, and then for the elderly, there will be additional dental services such as scaling and refilling. But what about those who are not the elderly or students, those middle-aged, for instance? They have no access to dental services in the public sector. So are you going to expand the services further to cover the middle-aged? Many of us here are the middle-aged. So how can you allow us to enjoy public dental services? Now, I have a suggestion. Can we hire more oral hygienists or and other practitioners other than dentists, dental practitioners, for example, for the primary school students dental scheme? They have oral hygienists and other technicians to help with scaling and so on. So if you do that, then maybe more of us will be able to enjoy the service in the public sector. Chief Executive. Thank you. I'd like to thank you for telling me that some residents have expressed their support for the policy address. I'm grateful that they support us. I must also thank my team, the three secretaries of departments, the 15 directors of bureau, and all the permanent secretaries. They were heavily involved in the policy address formulation. They gave their all to the task. In fact, many of the initiatives came from them. So I'm glad that our team is all doing their part to serve the public. And if there's recognition from the public, that would be the best encouragement for them. I'm going to convey the recognition to them. Thank you, Mr. Edward Leung, for telling me about the endorsement of some residents. Now, you talk about oral hygiene. In the policy address, I announced that I said that there's a working group on oral hygiene and dental care. And I've actually taken on board some of the recommendations of the working group on oral health and dental care. They've considered our what we could afford and the various needs. And so some measures came up. And during the consultation, I've heard many views on oral health services. So as I said, I've taken on board many of your suggestions, especially those coming from you members. Now, I heard just now that the public endorsed our policy address. That means that the views that we collected from the consultation could really help the public, and that's how we could leverage on HRS administering Hong Kong to achieve that. That's great. Now, for other oral hygienists or dental technicians and so on, well, I will ask the Working Group on Oral Health and Dental Care to consider your suggestion, because this is all about healthcare, technical issues involving dental care. You know, do we need to have fine division of labor or not? I think we need to leave that to the professionals to consider. Now, of course, there are many involved in the provision of the service. I keep an open mind. I hope the working group will be able to come up with some recommendations after they conduct a study. Thank you. Mr. Chen Pui Leung. Thank you. Chief Executive, I very much welcome the policy address. I think this is a pragmatic policy address that tries to seek breakthroughs, and it's also taken on board many of the views of the community. And many of the measures are targeted. In the policy address, Chief Executive, you said immediately you will open up the visa policy for Vietnamese, Laotians, and Nepalese. So in trawling for talents and retaining tenants, you pick these three countries in particular. What are the considerations? And for these three countries, what sort of talents are you eyeing, really? Chief Executive. Thank you, Mr. Chen. Before I answer your question, Mr. Chen, please allow me to give an answer to an earlier question. Now, there are three very important deputy secretaries of departments who were involved in formulation of the policy address as well, and they actually took up an important role. So I must thank them too here. Now, coming back to Mr. Chen's question, we want to attract talents from different places. So we should adjust our policy to open up the different areas as far as possible for us to draw more talents. Now, for some countries, we used to have visa control. And we probably imposed visa control because of previous problems we had, for example, with illegal immigrants. Some places may pose a threat on that front. So these are the factors we consider. And when we open up our visa policy to different places, we have to consider the pace. So we do it, they open up in an orderly manner. Now we see there are some countries that are developing well. Then we will have to consider whether the risk of illegal immigration is lowered because of the robust development in these places. So, and we need to take an orderly approach. So for the measures we've announced, we will review the progress before we consider further measures. But what's important is that we have a clear policy direction. That is, we're going to consider all possibilities. Now, Asian countries are the sources that we want to consider because they are our neighbors, they're close to us. So that's actually the main consideration. And as we gradually open up our visa admission to different places, while we're able to control the risk, we'll ensure that Hong Kong reaps the most benefit and stay the most competitive. Thank you.
Does that one? Ms. Doreen Kong, good morning, Chief Executive. I understand that you are determined to enhance your governance capability. You set 110 KPIs last year in your policy address. I want to know which KPIs you failed to meet and what are the reasons behind. Did you meet particular difficulties in meeting these KPIs? The Legislative Council is supposed to help the government implement its policies. For the KPIs that you failed to meet, will you think about reviewing why you failed to meet these KPIs? Will you discuss with the public and the Legislative Council members how you're going to achieve these KPIs? Chief Executive. Thank you, Ms. Kong. I understand that Ms. Kong really adheres to this result-oriented culture that I proposed. I have mentioned time and again that the reason for me to set up these KPIs is because I want to be able to achieve a result-oriented culture. In the past, we emphasized procedures, we emphasized controls. It's not wrong to stick to these targets. However, we have to make sure that the public can actually benefit from our work. So, the first thing that I propose is we have to change the culture of the government. I want to attach importance to results. I've heard people saying that the government has worked a lot faster and there's greater cooperation between different government departments, especially during Super Typhoon and the once-in-a-century torrential rainfall. As Ms. Kong said, some of the government departments may have faced challenges, and we want to help them go through these challenges. Say a policy may involve more than one government department. One government department may be responsible for that particular policy, but it also needs the help of other government departments. And if necessary, the high-ranking officials will come in or intervene. Say a government department fails to meet a certain KPI, as someone who comes up with the policy, we may be able to help solve or tackle these challenges. In the future, Ms. Kong may also give a helping hand to the government to help us achieve the targets. If you look at the appendix of the government of the policy address, among the 110 KPIs, at least four of them were not able to be materialized. I've studied the reasons behind the failure. There are some objective reasons behind it. For instance, for the Civil Service Code, I requested the relevant government departments to conduct further studies. That's why we didn't meet the particular API. For the other ones, after I received the comments from the particular advisory committee, I asked them to revise their comments or report. That's why we failed to meet that particular API. And for the other ones, we needed more time to work on the particular target. And I think it's reasonable. And for the final one, it involves consultation to be carried out in professional services sector. And I agree that we need further consultation. So there are three parts to these appendix of the policy address. Some of the work, there may be hiccups in the interim period, but in the end, we're able to achieve the target. So I don't blindly follow the KPIs. I look at the objective reasons behind if a particular KPI cannot be met. I will see if the relevant government departments have slacked, if it has done its job, or whether there are ulterior motives. If this is the case, we can stick to our performance-based evaluation system and take relevant actions. But from what I can see, we've exceeded a lot of our targets with just four KPIs that failed to be materialized. And for those four particular KPIs, I've elaborated the details in my policy address. So I've explained the challenges that we have experienced as we try to meet our KPIs. Also, I do not want our government departments to blindly follow the 110 KPIs that I proposed last year, as well as the 150 KPIs that I proposed this year. It's impossible that we just work on this 150 KPIs this year or 110 KPIs last year. I set these KPIs because I want to tell that these are the areas that we focus on. And the government departments who are responsible for the relevant work, they all work very hard. So I thank their effort. But we can always do better. What is most important is that members of the general public can benefit from our policies and measures. Mr. Lam Chun Sing, Chief Executive, recently there have been some fatal occupational incidents. You didn't mention about occupational safety in your policy address, but in the annex, there is a KPI that is relevant. In the next 5 years, you want to reduce the accidents for every 1,000 workers by 10%. I understand that some contractors that fall behind their standards have been deregistered, but there are challenges that we will face if we want to achieve this particular KPI. For instance, are there safety elements in the construction of buildings so that there will be fewer risks as we carry out the repair works? Also, for principal contractors, when they monitor the work of their subcontractors in occupational safety, are they responsible or should they be held accountable? Should they not outsource all the works to the subcontractors? Also, for construction sites with confined spaces, should we revise or amend the relevant code of practice? I wonder if the Chief Executive will consider setting up a high-level committee or a working group to review what kind of work we can do so that we are able to achieve the KPI concerning occupational health and safety. Thank you. Chief Executive, in terms of occupational health and safety, the government attaches a lot of importance. The Legislative Council has passed the relevant legislation in increasing the penalty concerning occupational safety and health. But just by raising the penalty is not enough. We have to promote an occupational safety and health culture, and everyone is responsible for it. The government is also responsible. We have to make sure that we have enough penalty in place. Also, within the government departments, we have to carry out enough inspections and we have to monitor the industry. More importantly, each stakeholder should attach importance to occupational safety and health. First, in terms of construction site management, the persons in charge are key. We want to make use of technology. To put it simply, I see that in some places they adopt robotics technology and it helps reduce site accidents. Also, we have to raise the safety awareness of construction workers. In some cases, the construction safety measures could have actually been boosted. And these can all be done by construction workers. To ensure we can promote the occupational safety culture, we need the effort of everyone. We need the effort of people who manage construction sites, those who operate construction machines. And we have to have good practice, including good division of labor. And we need the collective effort of everyone. Within the government bureau and government department, we've been promoting occupational safety culture. And we want to build this culture with the trade. It's not easy to change the culture within the trade, but we must do it. I see that the industrial accidents, well, if we just look at the number this year, if we compare the number between 2021 and 2022, we see a drop of some 60 cases. Of course, we can still do better. But as I said, to change the culture, it requires a lot of work. And we should not only rely on one person's effort to do it. We will continue to promote education and such culture and management practice with the trade. Thank you. Mr. Benson Luke. Good morning, Chief Executive. Hong Kong will only prosper if its young people thrive. President Xi, in his important speech last year, had expectation on our work on promoting youth development. And you also spared a part on this in your policy address. We have to help the four hurdles that young people face. Be it the youth development blueprint or your policy address, we see that there are measures to help promote education, entrepreneurship, housing, etc. for young people. I see that the government has been listening to the views of LegCo members and our young people. For housing in particular, if we ask our young people whether it's easy for them to get on the housing ladder, I believe the answer is negative. I understand the government has done a lot of work on housing. However, a lot of young people aren't able to even pay the down payment. Some say that they have to work effortlessly, work continuously for 20 years and they still aren't able to purchase a home. If you want our young people to stay in Hong Kong to establish their roots here and purchase a home, what will you tell our young people? Thank you.
Chief Executive, in the policy address I mentioned housing and land. I said this is our very top priority. So I take very seriously housing supply, whether it's in the public sector or the private sector. If we have sufficient land, then we have sufficient housing supply to meet market needs. When we help young people to buy a home, well, we have the Home Starter Scheme is one of the measures, actually, to help young people. Now, in fact, in the past, 85% of the first home buyers are those aged below 45. So we are actually helping this group. if we have sufficient housing supply, I believe housing prices will be stable. And as young people begin, you know, establish a career, then it will be easier for them to buy a home. We've also done much in helping people to get a mortgage. For example, a property worth $10 million. And we have various insurance schemes, so people were able to get a 90% mortgage. So we are using various means to help young people buy a home. But buying a home is an issue for the whole of Hong Kong. Our current policy is to reinforce every step of the housing ladder. Now we have public housing and HOS, green GSH, and subsidized housing and private housing and so on. So we want to have a housing ladder so people are able to meet their housing needs based on their own circumstances. In terms of supply, we've announced the figures because we have more spade-ready sites. And in the policy address, I mentioned that we have sufficient supply in the next few years. Of course, we have to consider the market situation as well. And then we are able to predict the trend of property prices. Now, what the government wants is stable housing market. And then people could do their own calculations and have regard to their own circumstances and buy a home that they can afford. Of course, they have to consider their own monthly income and see how much of a loan they can take out. So we are, you know, slowly, you know, increasing our supply. And then most important is that we have a good economy. If there's good economic development, people will earn more, and then they will be more confident in buying a home. They could afford to buy a better home too. So that's why we need to promote economic development. And then we have to help different sectors in the community to meet their needs. There's also support from the government. So for the disadvantaged, they are protected by the government's safety net. Thank you, Mr. Louis Long. Thank you, President. Good morning, Chief Executive. First, I must thank you for accepting our views, and you've decided to relax the property cooling measures that have been in place for over a decade. Now, I've been asking for complete removal of those measures. It's not the case, but still, I hope that you will continue to monitor the market. And if you see there is no speculation even after easing the measures, then you will agree to remove all the cooling measures. Now, on streamlining the administrative process to speed up the supply of land and speed up housing production, well, I'm all for that. Well, it was a long day yesterday, and last night I studied your policy address carefully. Even for the KPIs in the appendix, I've studied all of them. But I find that in the appendix, it seems that there are no KPIs on streamlining the administrative process. Maybe because I was too tired, I didn't catch those KPIs. But if that's not the case, can I ask the Chief Executive this? For the streamlining of administrative processes, would you also set KPIs? Chief Executive. Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Long. Mr. Long, I've been following your views made publicly on these issues. So apart from collecting views from the public, I follow your speeches in this council or on public on occasion. So I have a good idea of members' views on different issues. Yes, Mr. Long wants us to go all out. in removing the cooling measures. But I think, you know, in terms of the direction, I think we do see eye to eye, but it's a matter of the pace or how far we go. This time, I proposed how far we should go, because some still think that property prices are high, it's still housing is still not so affordable to the public. So that's why we need to strike a balance. And this is a decision after considering all factors. Mr. Long studies very carefully every aspect of the policy address. I thank you. Well, I must thank my colleagues too. This is the hard work they've put in to this policy address. So when you read the policy address so carefully, my colleagues will be happy. It's like, you know, someone writes a book and then there are readers. Of course, the author will be happy. So thank you. And on streamlining the administrative process, we can certainly always do better. If I set a KPI, let's say I set three KPIs and they just try to meet the three KPIs, but in fact, they have six KPIs in mind. And if I've only set three KPIs, they say, well, it's fine, we just meet the three KPIs and that's good enough. And that's not what I want to see. That's why I say there are KPIs only on specific items. There are reasons for setting APIs for only certain items. It's our judgment, after all. But at the end of the day, even if I do not set APIs, the public will have demands on them. You will, you know, expect them to do certain things. So that's why when it comes to setting KPIs for different policy measures, we have thought through them very carefully. And sometimes, you know, KPIs could be contradictory for different departments. For example, you know, there are case studies. Say one business wants to make a loan, the other just wants to make sure there is no bad loan. And so that's a conflict in itself. And when you set KPIs, you need to make sure that there is no contradiction between different departments. That's why when we set KPIs, we have to be very careful to think it through carefully. So for various reasons, we've only set KPIs for some item, for some measures. But of course, if you want to suggest KPIs, I'll be happy to listen to that. I think at the end of the day, it's all about benefiting the public, and we do see eye to eye on that. Ms. Nixie Lam, thank you. Chief Executive, you have various measures to promote childbearing. On behalf of many young couples who want to be parents, I must thank you. Now, first, you have announced this measure to give out a red packet. And then we have advocated extending the period for keeping frozen embryos. There's no measure in that respect. And then there are other measures too to increase the quota for public service, for example, and we support that. I think it's all about creating an enabling environment for people to have children. So we need to work together with the business sector. Now, we want to encourage the business sector to provide a family-friendly workplace. This is a key reason for people to decide whether to have their first child or second child. They worry that they have to take care of the children while they work. Now, there are bus companies that are studying providing child mining service next to their bus depots. You know, for big companies, if they set up child minding venues, there's no need for them to pay for everything. The government may give them subsidy. But then maybe they need to apply for a site, and then there may be a fire services consideration, land use issues, and so on. So if the government could relax certain policies while making sure safety is put first, I believe that will help to encourage companies to provide such facilities, and then it will be a good enabling environment for people to have children. Thank you. Chief Executive. Thank you. As I consider measures to promote childbearing, I've actually watched some of your interviews and TV clips. And so the chief executive actually works very hard. I follow very closely views of yours expressed through various channels, because we are working together to build a better Hong Kong. Now, I've actually considered many different views. You know, various suggestions were made to me on this issue. I've also compared the practices of different countries, some of the measures we've come up with that they have not, and for some other measures, you know, in their own countries already, they're not very effective, and if they are put in place in Hong Kong, it will be even less effective. Now, Ms. Nixie Lam has proposed extending the period for keeping frozen embryos, but frozen eggs. But then, you know, in terms of healthcare policy, we want to encourage people to have children as early as possible when they are in the best health condition. And in any case, 10 years is a long time. So that's why I have not taken on board this suggestion, because in terms of healthcare policy, you know, the healthcare sector wants would actually advise people to have children as young as soon as possible, because parents are healthy, that means the children will be healthy too. And on child rearing family practice, I'm all for that. Some businesses say that because the government does not set a policy direction, it's not easy for us to come up with measures on our own. So I see some businesses are keen. You've cited an example. I know many other businesses trying to do something, and these are businesses with more resources at their disposal. And apart from their social responsibility, many actually value very much their staff members, because their employees are an important asset to them. So I need to, encourage them to do more, and setting a clear policy direction would help. Because, say, at the board meetings or when the company considers its budget, if there is a clear policy direction coming from the government, it will be useful. That's why what I'm trying to do here is to set a clear policy direction on the part of the government in encouraging childbearing. We didn't have that before. We're doing it now because we want a birth rate of 2.1, but that's what we'd like to see, but it keeps dropping to 0.9. That's probably one of the lowest childbirth rate in the world. That's why we need to set a policy direction, and so we could enhance awareness in the community. And we want to encourage childbearing, and then it will be easier for different sectors to come up with child rearing family policy, friendly policies. I think if we have more newborns in Hong Kong, definitely it's going to be good for us. You know, some of these newborns may become a Nobel laureates. You never know. Now, some who are very much accomplished now may have come from grassroots families, but because there are opportunities available in the community and the government has policies in place too, so many of them become someone really accomplished. So that's why I want to set a policy direction. But please don't just focus on the $20,000 cash bonus. Well, you could call that a red packet, but it's more about that. More importantly, we should look at our policy direction. There are three aspects. One, we have the cash bonus, and then there's a priority for subsidized housing and public housing. There's a tax deduction, there's a childcare service, and there's increase in working family allowance, and we're also strengthening the neighborhood childcare service. So that's why everyone needs to work together to promote this policy. Thank you. Mr. Martin Liu. President, I'd like to thank the Chief Executive and his team for taking on board views from the community. This is a comprehensive policy address with great insight and depth. This will bode well for our economic development and people's livelihood. Now, in the policy address, the Chief Executive points out that global economies continue to shift east. This presents opportunities to Hong Kong. Now, of course, we need to turn our attention from the conventional American and European markets to the emerging markets. Now, under the Belt and Road Initiative, there will be more cooperation, and you're going to set up the International Legal Talent Training Institute, and there will also be more scholarship places for the Belt and Road countries and so on. So you have announced various measures. Now, we now have high inflation, high interest rates, and high risks and so on. So for Belt and Road countries, Hong Kong people are not familiar with them. So my question is, how will the SAR government help the community and businesses to seize upon opportunities from these emerging markets? And how can you help Hong Kong to work closer with businesses on the mainland? Thank you.
Chief Executive. Thank you, President. I thank member for the question. To promote the overall economic growth in Hong Kong, the government has to take the lead. Therefore, I visited different places, especially the emerging economies. I want to build the relationship with these economies. I want to expand the government-to-business sector relationship as well as the business-to-business relationships. Well, Mr. Martin Liao has his point. For new emerging markets, we may not be familiar with them. Our development, Trade Development Council plays an important role in promoting trade in this regard, and we have transformed from a fishery village to a international metropolis, and we have experience in opening up new markets. We are flexible, we are smart in grasping new opportunities. At the same time, we're able to control risks. In terms of business-to-business relationship or even people-to-people relationship, well, when I visited different places, I brought with me people with influence and with network, and they are all proactive in helping to expand the network. We do a lot of follow-up work afterwards. They may not be reported by the media. For instance, for the Dubai Chamber of Commerce, it wasn't set up in Hong Kong, but it's going to be set up here. And enterprises will, through this Chamber of Commerce, learn about the laws in Dubai and the bank services in Dubai and what opportunities are available. And we rely on this Chamber of Commerce to do all these. I will continue to visit different places, and if opportunities are available, I will bring with me a delegation to visit these places to expand our network. We need concerted effort in this regard. We have competitiveness. For countries or places that realize that we have the potential and opportunities, they will approach us. There have been some successful deals. For instance, one time I brought an enterprise that is engaged in new energy transport, and at the end we were able to sign an agreement with the country. And enterprises in that country are interested in Hong Kong, and they're able to think about coming to Hong Kong. And we rely on the Trade Development Council to help promote Hong Kong. And I'm going to set up more ETOs to expand our promotional effort. We have Invest Hong Kong, and it tries its best to disseminate relevant information. I hope that our business sector or chambers of commerce will play their role as well. We need to work hand in hand and do our part in our roles to make contributions. The government will take the lead and open the door for everyone. And together, we will be able to open more small doors and windows and bring about new opportunities. Thank you. Mr. Adrian Ho. Good morning, Chief Executive. This August to September, in 22 transaction days, the transaction volume was lower than $100 million. On the 7th of September, some 700 stocks saw zero transactions. We are facing great challenges in Hong Kong, and it affects the confidence of people here. I think the government should bring people out of this challenge. I wonder what the chief executive will do to help stimulate the stock market so that people will resume their confidence in Hong Kong's market. Also, the financial secretary estimated that the financial deficit would be $140 billion, and our reserve has dropped to $820 billion. How is the government going to pull together enough resources to ensure that all large-scale infrastructure projects will be completed? Members usually ask just one question. In order to leave enough time for other members to ask questions, Chief Executive, please try to just respond to one question. Well, I will try my best. First, I don't agree that we have a confidence crisis. We are facing challenges, but at the same time, we're faced with opportunities. We have both opportunities and challenges, as mentioned in the policy address. I think that we have more opportunities compared to challenges. Reasons being that Hong Kong is the only city in the world that gather all the advantages from both the mainland and Hong Kong. We should be alert, but we should not be too scared. Our greatest source of confidence comes from our country. In the policy address, I mentioned that the greatest opportunity we have is our country. We see the greatest economic growth in Asia. The average economic growth in Asia is higher than that of the rest of the world, so we focus on Asia. Hong Kong is a special administrative region in China, and we are also a major city in Asia. With just 5 hours of flight, we're able to reach half of the destinations in the world. So we should not underestimate the risks that we are facing, but at the same time, we should reinforce our advantages. We should grasp the opportunities, address our shortcomings and any potential risks. I believe that we're able to achieve positive growth this year in terms of our GDP. Also, we're going to open up new business opportunities. If we make use of these opportunities, we'll be able to cope with any risk in a confident manner. In terms of government's revenue, we are facing some negative factors. But in my policy address, I've stressed 2 points. First, for different large-scale projects, we're rolling out a new structure that is a financing framework for major development projects. We are going to use the investment capital in the market to support our major development projects. Also, we have to ensure the fiscal sustainability of the government and these projects. I thank the financial secretary in this regard. He has spent a lot of time to ensure our fiscal sustainability. Of course, we are met with challenges, but as mentioned in the policy address, we have both strengths and weaknesses. We need to address our shortcomings. But at the same time, we should not undermine ourselves. We should not be overly confident. We should make a just judgment on the situation, and we should follow the 14th five-year plan to develop 8 centers. It is our country's policy, and we're going to get the support from our nation. As mentioned in the policy address, we are getting the support from our country to develop our economy. And this is the greatest source of our confidence. Also, we are highly internationalized. We are connected with the world. We have people who meet international standards who are able to provide services. We serve as both a super connector as well as a role which helps boost the value of super connector. Thank you. Mr. Chang Hock Fong, Chief Executive, in your policy address, you mentioned a number of policies to boost fertility, and one of it is the newborn baby bonus. Another policy that appeals to people is the newborn flat selection priority scheme. I believe this will help address people's needs. I understand that you've worked hard on enhancing speed, quantity, and quality of housing. You mentioned that in the coming 10 years, we'll have 100,000 more housing units. Have you thought about how to boost the supply of public rental housing units so that families who want to have baby can be prepared? In the past, there has been less than 10,000 public housing units available in the market, HOS units in the market yearly. So can you promise that you will build more HOS units so that families who'd like to have babies can be better prepared? Chief Executive, I thank Mr. Chen for the question. We have a split between public housing units and private housing units. If we have identified enough land, we are able to also boost the supply of private housing units. We will look at the demand based on the actual circumstances. It's never easy to distribute resources evenly. Where should we put more resources into? This is the question that we have to think about, and we have to ensure that we have enough supply of home ownership scheme units. I believe that my colleagues here attending the meeting have heard all your views. Well, we have a few considerations. Well, the situation is different every year. In the coming 10 years, we are able to build 410,000 housing units. But the situation every year varies. For the first 5 years, we will see a few supplies, but in the following 5 year period, we'll be able to see more supplies. As to how we're going to make an adjustment after the first 5 year period, we will have to look at the actual circumstances. We'll have to take a balanced approach. As to where there will be room for adjustment for particular projects, we will look into it.
Chief Executive, are you prepared to take one more question? Sure. Ms. Jofi Chen. Thank you, President. I would like to thank the Chief Executive for taking on board more than 30 suggestions from the FTU. This is a very comprehensive policy address, you know, food co-thing, housing, and national security and everything. Healthcare means that we're going to improve the drug registration system, and then food means that you're going to promote e-commerce, and then housing, we're going to bid farewell to SDUs, and we're going to start from children. And you said that there'll be a priority allocation scheme for newborns, and then living means you are going to add two more stops at Chungking Circuit and Chunwan East, and that's because we've been asking for that for a long time. We've collected signatures from the residents, actually. And also for national security, there will be legislation for the Article 23 next year, so that will enhance the happiness of the community. I must give a like to you and your team. Now, on behalf of the FTU, I have a question on paragraph 132. 136, that's the 3 year pilot scheme for those aged 40 or above. If they work 18 months in continuously, they will get $20,000 in assistance. That's a 3 year reemployment allowance pilot scheme. Now, I've consulted women around age 40 around me, that includes myself. $20,000 would not be enough for us to decide to bear a child, but then $20,000 would be enough to encourage people to rejoin the labor market. You know, there is a high unemployment rate, especially among young people. It's a double-digit figure. So would you lower the age threshold so even young people will be able to benefit from this reemployment allowance pilot scheme? Thank you. Chief Executive. Thank you, President. Thank you, Ms. Chen. Thank you for your encouraging words. Now, my team, my civil service colleagues are happy to have your endorsement and recognition. The reemployment allowance, again, is a matter of how far we go and how much we do. For various reasons, for those who have not worked for 3 months or more, we give them this reemployment allowance to rejoin the labor market. I'm sure most members of the public want to rely on themselves. They don't need such encouragement or incentives because they want to contribute to the community. They want to work and realize their own their self-worth. But then we know that there is a shortage of labor. And for others, they have to consider their roles in the family. And that's why there are no incentives for them to go back to the job market. And that's why we have proposed this re-employment allowance pilot scheme, because we want elderly and middle-aged persons above 40 years or older to unleash their potential. We want to attract workers from this age groups. So when we deploy resources, we have to consider the effectiveness of initiatives. Now, for those aged below 40, they usually have their own considerations. And so that's why we're not offering incentive for those aged 40 or above. At the same time, we have to allocate resources properly among different sectors. So that's why for every policy we have full consideration on the extent of the scheme. And this time for this pilot scheme, we have set the target for those age 40 or above. Thank you. The chief executive's question and answer session ends. The chief executive will now leave the chamber. Will members please stand up? I now adjourn the council until 11 a.m. on Wednesday, the 1st of November, 2023.